We're four friends who live across the globe
and share a love of Bon Appetit's YouTube channel.
So we came together to bring you our thoughts on what BA serves up
and try our hands at recreating their dishes.
Welcome to Pod Appetit.
Hi, I'm Amanda.
Hi, it's LJ.
And it's me, Meg.
We are back. Welcome to another episode of Pod Appetit. As you can hear, Justine is not with us today. She's a little under the weather, but don't worry. It's not coronavirus.
that we know of. And she's definitely social distancing, so.
Oh, yes. No, I've been messaging with her. It's a different sort of stomach bug. Yeah. I'll just leave it at that. Yeah, Justine is not with us today, but we love her, and she is definitely social distancing. I actually texted her right before we started, and she was like, I just woke up. And I was like,
aww.
So,
it's getting lots of rest.
Yeah, it's a little bit of a weird world that we're in now from 2 weeks ago.
What a difference 2 weeks makes, eh?
Oh my god, right? It feels like we talked a month ago, but it was only 2 weeks.
I know.
Oh my gosh.
Crazy.
You know, we're gonna kick things off talking about what we've been up to culinary-wise, like we do every time, but our tales may be a little different than they have been in the past. LJ, what have you been up to? Do you have any tales of culinary mishaps with all of this going on?
Well, actually, I've been quite lucky in that I have a regular slot with an online delivery company in the UK that gets pre-booked every week. And so far, that has worked out. I don't know how bad things are going to get. That might not pan out to be the case in future weeks, but so far I haven't had a huge amount of disruption in terms of being able to get hold of ingredients. It's more thinking ahead and making sure that I've put them in my order way more in advance than I would normally do, which I did remember to do this week, which was good. Next week I've no idea what the situation will be because my order literally came today, so the new order hasn't been sort of logged yet, so I don't know what the situation is going to be like. But I have been able to continue with basically baking, which has been really a good kind of distraction, I guess, from everything crazy that's been going on right now and stressing everyone out. I made the camouflage fudge last week, which went well, although I would say the decoration that you do on the top to make it look camouflagey, it didn't come out quite as nicely as Sarah Jumpel's version. I think because the mixture, the cream cheese mixture that you make and kind of split to do the two different colours, mine seemed a lot looser than Sarah Jumpel's version. And it's just sort of when I started putting it on top of the brownie mix, it kind of all kind of just sort of went into one and there wasn't as much kind of separation of the colours. But it still kind of looked nice and it tasted delicious. It was like a lovely, delicious, fudgy, brownie consistency, and it kept really well. So we had that throughout the entire week, which was needed when I was stress eating from all the anxiety over Corona. But this week I'm hoping to do the biscuits. So the sour cream and onion biscuits is a Molly Bars recipe. I haven't done that yet, but it looks like a pretty straightforward recipe from what I can tell. So I might either do that later today or later next week. And I was able to get the ingredients for that. I was able as well, I suppose I should mention that, God, it really does feel like it's been years since we last recorded, even though it's only 2 weeks. I've aged about 10 years, but my birthday was the week before last, and it was just before things started getting more serious over here in the UK. And it was just before we were all advised to start working from home and like not travel so much and leave the house. So literally the day before that all happened was my birthday, and I went for breakfast at Balthazar in London and basically recreated the everything on the menu episode that Claire and Delaney did, which was absolutely joyous and I loved it. And I storied it all for Pod Appetit, so it's on our highlights as the last normal day in London before Corona. So yeah, that would be a nice memory to look back on when we're not able to leave the house anymore.
Yeah, that looked delightful. I think everyone should definitely go check out your Balthazar breakfast. Did you have the giant bowls of coffee?
Yes, they were wonderful. I love those bowls of coffee. I also had the hot chocolate at the end of the meal with the tartine kind of bread and jams, kind of conserves, as they call them over there. And yeah, it was absolutely delightful. And there was a little pot of Nutella as well that you could dip your bread in, which was delicious. Mm. It was just like... it was a lovely breakfast. I wish I could do that every day.
Breakfast oysters.
Breakfast oysters, that's what I started with, because I was like, I can't pay homage to Claire and Delaney without doing breakfast oysters. So yeah, it was great.
What was your verdict on breakfast oysters?
Loved it. Absolutely loved it. I didn't get sick this time, thank God. It's always a bit of a Russian roulette with oysters, no matter where you get them from. But yeah, it was fine and loved it. It was really delicious. I love oysters.
Well, I'll go next. I made the granola cookie clusters, and there will be a side dish episode of that coming up, so you can hear all the details on that soon. And then last night I made some smoothies from a Carla recipe. Ooh. That's like, they're called, what did she name them? Monkey on a Date.
Oh.
Because, I'm sorry, LJ, they have bananas in them. But, like, they're so pureed. I don't even know that you would get much of a banana taste, honestly.
No, people have told me that my whole life with various different food things that have banana in, and it's always a lie, so I don't believe you.
But, yeah, it was good. And so I made those, and my mom and my sister Addie and I had them, and it's from a culture article that she did that was like very much like, you don't have to have an exact recipe, you just kind of go with it. And there's lots of different things you can substitute in and out. So it's Monkey on a Date because the bananas, and then there's dates in it, and peanut butter, and then you can do various kinds of liquid. I used almond milk. She had said you could use buttermilk or rice water. Like, there were lots of different options. But I used almond milk. And what else? It has a little bit of oats in it. You can basically add other things by taste. Like, you can add in some coconut oil, or you can add in some honey, or you can, you know, add in lots of different things. But... it was really delicious, and I think I would definitely make it again. Like, my mom asked for seconds, and for those who have heard my mom on my side dish episodes knows that she doesn't always like my cooking efforts. So
that's good then.
I have a smoothie most mornings, so that sounds delicious to me. I love dates in a smoothie.
Yeah, I can send you the recipe thing for it, Meg.
That'd be great. And also, I might suggest to anyone looking for a smoothie, Molly has a lot of Instagram stories. She makes a smoothie often.
Daily smoothie.
In the morning. Yeah, the daily smoothie. So lots of smoothie inspiration there. So not to be totally pessimistic, but I feel like this might be my last update for a while as far as making Bon Appetit recipes, just because of the general situation, the quarantine, the lockdown. Yeah. But in the meantime, I made Sarah Jampel's lentil salad yet again. I think I've made this 5 times now. But this helped me make another recipe because I already had lemons and Castelvetrano olives on hand for the lentil recipe, which are 2 ingredients for Delaney's Little Ripper cocktail.
Yeah.
So I pretty much already had all the ingredients on hand, and I still had Averno from our Halloween episode that I used to make Halloween cocktails. Mm-hmm. So I already had everything on hand to make the Little Ripper. And this is in one of the videos we're going to recap today, but it's a mixed drink. He says it tastes like Coke, and I thought that before even watching the video. Tastes like alcoholic Coke. It was really good.
Oh, nice. That's interesting, because I wasn't really sure. I'd never had a Averno, so I couldn't imagine what the taste was going to be. The Coke reference is interesting. I'd be interested in trying that.
Yeah, I think it's a pretty good comparison. It's like, oh, yeah, it does taste like that. Interesting. And finally, I made buckwheat crepes with creamy leeks and baked eggs. This was really, really good. I picked it because, you know, I thought it would taste good, but I was surprised by how tasty it was. And it was an older recipe written by a chef who isn't one of the YouTube personalities, so I wasn't really sure what to expect from the flavor profile. But I love leeks. The creamy leek mixture had a kick of cayenne, which added a nice bit of spice to it. But it's just sort of some leeks that you cook up. You make crepes and you put this leek mixture in the middle of the crepes. You make a little well in the leeks and you put the egg in it and then you bake it all in the oven. Oh, really tasty.
Nice.
Probably see that on our Instagram at some point coming up here.
Definitely. And the little ripper's already there.
So, yep.
Yeah.
Well, on the menu for today's episode, we have Andy makes pasta with tomatoes and chickpeas from the Test Kitchen. Pastry chef attempts to make gourmet bagel bites, gourmet makes. Pro chefs bake muffins without measuring ingredients, Test Kitchen talks. Brad makes a master stock, it's alive. Pro chefs make their favorite cocktails, 10 recipes, Test Kitchen talks. Pastry chef attempts to make gourmet Girl Scout cookies, gourmet makes. Recreating Bobby Flay's macaroni and cheese carbonara from Taste, a reverse engineering episode. And finally, Trixie Mattel tries to keep up with a professional chef, back-to-back chef. So we're going to kick things off with Andy makes pasta with tomatoes and chickpeas from the Test Kitchen.
This dish has a better name than that, right? Pasta e checchi or checchi or whatever it is. Like,
yes.
Why is it the YouTube algorithm that means that they haven't used the actual name for the dish?
I think it has to be. That they were like, oh, someone might search for chickpeas, but they're not going to search for pasta ricetti or whatever.
Yeah. Because I was like, pasta with tomatoes and chickpeas? What is that? And then I was like, oh, it's like it's an Italian dish. It's not just like, I don't know. It was odd. I was confused by the name of the video, but I guess the algorithm is something they have to think about, I guess.
I wanted to at least, I know this isn't recipe based, but Andy's shirt of, and his Winona shirt and his thoughts about Winona and Saks Fifth Avenue just warmed my heart.
It was real a nostalgia kick for me because I was like, oh my God, yeah, I forgot about that. It's so funny.
I stan a Winona Ryder stan. He definitely got a lot of comments on that video because I believe he shared the link to the t-shirt where he bought it after the YouTube video because everyone was like, where can I get that shirt? Nice.
And I also enjoyed that when Rappo came to taste the dish, Andy's like, well, I'm wearing a shirt that doesn't have holes. And like, that was like his big triumph for being professional.
I'm curious to know what you thought of this dish, Amanda, because it was like another kind of a in between a soup and a pasta, like a hybrid dish. And I was like, oh, is this another gateway soup for Amanda? Or was she really like, no, thank you?
I was like kind of on this one, partially because the soup aspect of it. I don't know. Like, I did like the idea, like the kind of pasta that he used, but when Rappo was like, should I use a fork or a spoon, and he was like, spoon, I was like, oh, I would use a fork.
You're allowed to use a fork if it helps you get over the fact that it's a halfway to a soup, then use a fork.
The thing is I would probably do that and just like not get a lot of the liquid, like that just I would just kind of
interesting
pass on the liquid.
I like the look of the pasta as well. I've never had calamari before. It looks really good, though.
I would really love to try this pasta. I love the name. I love that it looks like calamari, which is obviously where it gets its name from.
So
and
cute.
I really like how Andy described the chickpeas hiding in the pasta. I thought that was really cute. For some reason, I'm like, yes, I want little hidden chickpeas when I'm eating this. I thought it ended up looking a lot tastier than I expected. Maybe again it was just the really banal name they gave it in the video title. I was like, chickpeas and tomatoes, okay. But then once he made it, it looked really tasty to me.
That's partly why I was so annoyed by the fact that they didn't use the right name for it, because as you say, tomatoes and chickpeas and pasta is not an appetizing name for a dish, but
yeah, just sounds kind of boring.
Pasta e ceci, you're like, ooh, what is this exotic dish that I could be making? And it, you know, it just conjures up different imagery in your head.
I thought this video was fun too because it sort of doubled down on Andy being the sassy character in the test kitchen or what have you. They tend to focus on this often, and they asked him, are you spicy or sensitive, Andy? And I was like, okay, that is just a leading question. That's so obvious. Yes.
He went with both. I was going to ask you guys, are you spicy, sensitive, or both?
Oh, absolutely spicy.
I feel like I'm a bit like Andy, like I'm incredibly sensitive, but I'm also the most spicy at the same time.
I feel like realistically, I'm probably sensitive, as my entire family always says, oh, Amanda's the sensitive one.
Right.
But I love spicy food, so I have to have a little bit of spice in there.
You got to have a bit.
Absolutely.
I actually think from when I first watched this video to where the world is now, this is actually a really good recipe for people who are trying to use up stuff in their kitchen.
Because, that's true.
You know, a lot of people have pasta because everyone's stockpiling it. A lot of people have like canned like tomatoes and chickpea. I certainly do have all of that stuff in my cupboard. So it's just like, just generally because I buy it and forget that I've already got some. And so it's actually quite a good recipe for people to maybe lean on in these crazy days of not being able to get your hands on stuff that lasts for a long time. It's a good kind of store cupboard type recipe.
If only we had known 2 weeks ago.
I know, right?
What today would be like.
Should have stocked up on chickpeas. Don't have any of those. Speaking of things that you quote unquote should have in your kitchen, when Andy was like, you have to do both the garlic and the onion. If you're watching this YouTube channel, you probably have that. And I thought, oh, Andy, there's some people who can't cook at all and they just enjoy watching you.
Yeah, that was funny. I think their assumption is that everyone who watches them wants to cook, but I don't think that's necessarily the case for a certain percentage of the audience, for sure. Did anyone see Meme Appetit do cooking on their stories over the past couple of weeks while they've been social distancing as well? It's been quite funny. But I think it was Harry is one of them that did cooking on their stories last night, and he made Andy's bolognese recipe, and he didn't have all of the right ingredients. Like, he used the wrong colour wine and stuff, and I just thought it was hilarious. I was messaging him being like, oh my God, Andy's going to be mad because you use red wine instead of white wine. And then there was the screenshot of Andy being like, what the fuck are you doing? And I just thought it was hilarious. It was so funny.
The next episode that we're talking about is Pastry Chef Attempts to Make Gourmet Bagel Bites. Gourmet Makes. We're getting spoiled with Gourmet Makes this batch of videos.
Pizza in the morning, pizza in the evening, pizza at supper time. When pizza's on a bagel, you can have pizza anytime.
I don't know what you're doing, but I assume that's the jingle.
It's the jingle. They showed it briefly. Claire was watching it in the video, and all of the memories came flooding back. I'm like, I know that jingle. It's in my head forever, probably.
I've never had a bagel bite, and I feel like I'm missing out. They look cute.
They are
cute. They're
pretty
good. I have to say, with the jingle, I sang along. I didn't even realize I was singing along with the jingle until it ended. And then I went like in the video and I was like, oh, yep, that is ingrained within me.
Yeah, it was nice to have two Gourmet Makes this batch. I don't want to just compare the two, but I guess I'm going to. Did she seem kind of peeved from the get-go in this one to you guys? I guess between the two Gourmet Makes, I liked the other one better just because Claire seemed a little down in this episode to me in general, or am I just imagining things?
Yeah, and I agree with you, but I'm not quite sure why, because normally she's down when something's really hard and she's not sure how she's going to push through, but this seemed like it would be an easy one, and it was easy. Like, it was just, she knows how to make bagels, it's just making like a miniature version and putting some fun toppings on.
She was doing three Gourmet Makes at once, based on when the 2 week gap was. I think she was doing this, Girl Scout cookies, and what was the last one?
Combos.
And I think she was doing, like, all of those at once. So I wonder if she was having, like, combos issue or something, and then, like, had to go in and start the bagels or something. Like, it definitely felt like she was doing multiple Gourmet Makes, so her mood may have been affected by a different project. Because right. largely she seemed to have fun with the bagels.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Except for when Chris was like, you have to remake these. They're too crispy. And it reminded me of the old days of Chris being like, well, you have to temper the chocolate.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
To which she said, I don't feel good about that criticism and I don't appreciate it. But without being able to taste or try the bagels ourselves, obviously, I think Chris was right. And I believe Andy mentioned they would have to go through yet another bake.
Bake,
so they
yes.
did definitely seem way too crispy that first batch.
But exactly.
Then she knocked it out of the park later. As she said, yeah. she has a pretty vast bagel education, both in cooking and eating bagels. So she really got to put that to use. My favorite part of this episode, though, which really delighted me, was just how she scaled down everything to this miniature scale. She makes the little tiny pepperonis, the little tiny broccoli yes. florets. It
oh
was
my
so
god,
cute.
The broccoli florets were so cute.
I love that bit as well, because I love feeling like a giant with anything miniature. And I had also recently just watched Downsizing, that movie, where everybody gets shrinked. And I mean, I don't want to talk about the movie too much because I didn't enjoy the ending, but
it's a hot mess.
It's a hot mess. Yeah, that's just but the concept I was really on board with at the beginning. I was like, oh, isn't it so funny when they're so small and they've got to have like miniature versions of stuff. And yeah, so I just thought it was funny that me watching this video had tied in with me watching that movie, because I was like, oh, I'm all about the tiny things right now. But yeah, I thought making those tiny pepperonis and the little mortadella as well, where she kind of
so
punched
cute.
The little things out, was so sweet. I thought it was interesting that when she was taking everyone's orders for what they want on their like perfect pizza, and nobody's order was anything close to the actual making perfect pizza that they all agreed was the perfect
pizza. Oh,
that's
true.
I feel like, was it
Andy's was maybe kind of similar.
Yeah, yeah,
and I
maybe.
Brad with the mix of mushrooms, like.
Yeah, possibly. But it was just, I just thought it was amusing that people were like going wildly off from that like recipe.
That's
that they,
true.
Like,
that's a good point.
The tuna melt. I was like, who wants that? I was like, I'm not into tuna and cheese either. I'm kind of with Chris on that.
You don't like hot fish and cheese?
No, of course I don't. That sounds, I mean, I like them both separately, but oh goodness me. Yeah, it was crazy. But yeah.
All right, well, I'll just be by myself, team tuna melt over here.
But I also don't understand pineapple on a pizza either. I think
not my favorite.
Who was it who had the mushroom, the pineapple and the olive? I knew that Delaney was disgusted by it, and I was like, I'm with him.
Yeah, Meg said it was Sola.
Yeah, yeah, it was mental. But I love the end of this episode where everybody came together and they had like a little pizza party, like making them all. That was cute.
I've definitely had a make your own pizza party at other people's houses. It's really fun to make your own little personal pizza, or like at Pizza Hut when you were a kid and you could get your own personal pan pizza. Love it.
Oh my God. That's really taking me back.
Nostalgia. I also really liked just that whole part of the video. It was really reminiscent of the Ben and Jerry's video, getting everyone involved, mm-hmm. making their own thing. I really loved that.
It was very cute.
Yeah. Oh, Ben and Jerry's must have been at the same time as this one, because she talked about, like, what about the ice cream? Is it still frozen after they had the...
when the freezer went down?
Yes. Yes, because one of the trays went missing. Yeah, I was like, how rude for the freezer to go. But that's not the first time that's happened as well, is it? Unless it's the same time and it's just showed up in multiple videos. Probably that
well,
one.
Well,
but yeah.
When she says, like, well, it's okay. We didn't have any meat. It's fine to refreeze. And they were like, there's tons of meat.
Yeah, yeah. It was funny.
She didn't say it directly on the camera, but you know how excited she was for the clam pie, and then she was really not excited about it? I think it's because of the whole defrosting situation, and I think she was personally thinking, oh no,
yes.
defrosted clams, but didn't want to be rude about it on camera.
Yeah.
The real star of this episode, though, Andy's complexion.
Oh.
Oh my God.
Oh. Totally. That was hilarious. Just that in the background on a stand so everyone can see
just it. Hovering so the whole funny. Time.
So funny. And I love that Claire put it there and he kept going like, I didn't do that. And he'd like put it down and then the next time it would be right back up like just there for all to see.
Hilarious.
I liked the little opening where Delaney's like, I'm doing gourmet makes now. And I thought, oh, that would be fun to see a full-on, like, Delaney with Claire for a gourmet makes or something.
The guy but, who can't bake it all.
Yeah, as we're going to learn in our next next video that we're recapping. So next up is Pro Chefs Bake Muffins Without Measuring Ingredients, Test Kitchen Talks. Yeah, Delaney cannot bake. And I was like, Delaney baking is me attempting any other sort of recipe.
Well, first I thought, well, this is impossible because I weigh absolutely everything because we don't tend to use cups a lot in the UK unless I'm cooking from an American recipe. But then I realized that they were allowed to use some of the utensils that they had to act as like a kind of stand-in for a cup mm-hmm. measurement. And yeah. I was like, okay, if you're allowed to do that, then I can see how you can eyeball proportions. Because baking, actually, it's all about proportions mm-hmm. as to whether it tastes right. So if you can kind of figure that out, then the math of that, then it doesn't matter if you get it exactly right as long as you can get the ratios okay. Mm-hmm. So I was like, okay, that's not as difficult as I thought it was when I first read the title of the episode. But yeah, some people didn't figure that out as well and were just sort of trying to eyeball it, which is very difficult to do.
Yeah, I think it was Christina who said that it's really all about ratios and proportions with baking.
Yeah.
That's absolutely mm-hmm. right. And as you said, it's interesting to see who used like the muffin tin to measure or who just eyeballed it. And it made me think, like with a lot of these test kitchen talks, maybe they weren't totally clear in the rules when they were telling each chef how to prepare yeah. this, which was why I thought, oh, maybe that's why Brad and Carla literally eyeballed it. Maybe that's what they were told when they were being debriefed. But
I also thought Carla's looked pretty decent.
That's the other difficult thing about this video and similar videos, it's really hard to judge as an audience because, yeah, they all looked pretty good to me except for Delaney's.
Wow, really Delaney's.
I know, right? What a disaster. But I would appreciate a little bit more structure in these videos, like some sort of judging so that at least at the audience we have that closure yeah. as to who won or who did the best.
Yeah.
Or even a comparison to the original recipe. We never got to see the muffins as intended.
Also, Alex rejected sifting as part of his baking narrative, which I thought was hilarious. And I also thought you could tell, other than like people who understand the ratios as the important thing, you could also mark out who is bakes often from those who don't, from the people who know that buttermilk comes with measurements on the side, because that's like if you're using yeah. buttermilk and you know the ingredient because you use it a lot, then you'll know those things. I don't think in the UK buttermilk doesn't come with that on the general kind of branded containers, but butter certainly has the markings along mm-hmm. the side of the yeah. package. And yeah, I feel like sometimes those are the things that you're like, oh, you must do this all the time because you know that. Whereas other people would be like, oh, I don't know, with the buttermilk.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah, Delaney said something about, I don't really want to sift these because I don't really, and he just sort of trailed off and the editorial said care, question mark.
Yeah, that was hilarious. Uh-huh.
I love that he was a disaster human from start to finish in this, and it was such a cherry on top when the butter itself wouldn't even stay on the muffin at the end. And then he threw it away and the muffin landed face down. It was just too perfect.
Yeah.
Oh, so funny.
He was yeah. so entertaining in this.
Oh, I also really liked the editing. At one point, Chris says, why invite failure? And then it cut to Delaney failing. And they would always cut to him doing exactly what everyone else was saying you shouldn't do, like over mixing the batter. And you just see him
yes.
going to town on the batter.
Uh-huh.
But he wasn't the only one that made boo-boos. Like, Solo exploded her butter in that microwave, which
in the newly cleaned microwave.
Well, do you think it was newly cleaned, or do you think it was part of the stuff that Claire had to clean off?
Well, Solo exploded the butter and she said, oh no, Claire's gonna be really mad at me, she just cleaned this.
Oh, I missed that. Yeah, yeah, of course. Yeah, okay.
So I think it was right after Claire had, because Solo felt so bad.
I would disown Solo if I was Claire. I'd be like, how dare you?
I did want to say, we had gotten a message on, I think it was Twitter, from Margaret, who, her prediction on this video was, she said, Sola dominates. She is a queen. All hail Sola.
She was pretty much right, too.
Yeah, Sola did well.
I love how savage Sola was. She just tries Andy's and then says, mine were better, and walks away.
Yeah, watching this, I definitely enjoyed this video, but I thought, man, Sola does need her own show. Like, we need a Sola show.
She really does. Someone on Reddit suggested that she should recreate Bon Appetit recipes from old magazine issues from, like, the 70s or 80s, and I thought that was a great idea.
That's such a good idea for a series, because they've got such a back catalog to work with. Like,
yeah, she could, like, update them or modernize them or something.
That's a great idea.
One of the other things I liked in this video is the continuing thread throughout the entire BA universe of Andy is always hungry and trying to eat things.
Yeah. Who's always hungrier, Andy or Delaney? Maybe it's a tie.
I think it's a tie. I think Andy's the sneakiest, though. He just pops out. He definitely is.
He just, like, lurks there for a minute, and then he's just like, hey?
Hey, I've been here this whole time. And I'm definitely owed some food.
Next up, we have Brad makes a master stock. It's alive.
Another great recipe for social isolation.
Absolutely.
I must say. I've actually made stock this afternoon. Not master stock, but stock generally. At first I thought this was the Thanksgiving stock recipe because it's very similar, but it actually isn't. When I checked it out, it's a slightly different stock recipe, but I love a good stock recipe, so I don't think you can ever have too much, and I really enjoyed Brad doing it in his own unique Brad way.
Yeah, Brad with an actual recipe on It's Alive is a new one.
I know.
What is the world coming to?
Even Brad's got a recipe. The world is really different to 2 weeks ago.
So we've gone from breakfast oysters at the top of the episode to breakfast stock. And I have to say, I totally agree to just have stock for breakfast. I love it. I do it often.
Me too. I love it as well.
Amanda looked horrified, though.
Well, as you know, stock, I don't, as a, again, a soup-averse person, I am not a fan of soupy type things. So the idea of just drinking stock for breakfast, I was just like, oh,
it's really good.
Can't do it. Though I look forward to his upcoming videos that he was announcing towards the end, like where he's going to do the add-ins for the stock, breakfast stock and all
The fermented turmeric ginger thing.
Yeah,
that sounded good. Something I found really interesting about this video, and I'd be curious to know if this is leading up to videos coming in the future, but they introduced a lot of side characters of the BA cinematic universe, let's say.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We met a lot of new people. We saw a lot of people that we see often, but just kind of in the background, like Anna Stockwell and Ryan, who is Rappo's assistant. And then we met John and Tyre, mm-hmm. I believe. I'm not sure how to pronounce the other gentleman's name. But John was adorable. And he comes up and says, should I eat this? And Brad says no, which is surprising because Brad usually tells everyone to eat everything. And then he eats it anyway.
Oh, that just like gelatinous animal fat on the basically.
That looks so gross. Just looks,
I really hate vomit jokes at the best of times, so that wasn't my favorite bit of the video. But I did think a lot of this video was absolutely hilarious. One of the bits in particular was Brad straining the stock into cheesecloth. Which did not work out.
which was funny. I couldn't stop laughing at that bit. I also liked his traumatizing celery story.
Yes. Oh, yeah, his misophonia stuff. I kept thinking about Heidi from Vibrant Visionaries, who listens, and I know who lives out near you, Meg, because she has trouble with misophonia, and I know, like, that's been one of her things that's, like, when she's listened to our side dishes, is making sure, like, those don't bother her, so.
Yeah.
I know. My husband has misophonia.
My husband, too.
Yeah, but unlike Brad, he seems to think it's everyone else's problem and not his problem. Whereas what I appreciated about Brad was that he was like, it's not me. He was like, it's not you, it's me, it's my thing that I have to deal with. And I was like, yes, finally. I was like, I'm not saying that people shouldn't be considerate of it, of course. But like, sometimes, like, I have learned to really, like, be mindful of how much noise I'm making because I live with someone who really hates it. So I always chew with my mouth closed. I mean, you should anyway, but you know, it's easy to not care about that if you're not around someone who has a problem with it. But it's I always chew with my mouth closed. I always make a special effort not to be like overly noisy when I'm eating. And even then he's just like looking at me like, how dare you make any noise when you're eating? And I'm like, well, you make everyone make some noise, like you can't get rid of it. Like I have to do, like, oh man. But yeah,
I sympathize so much, LJ. I feel like you've just described my home life.
It's so funny.
Speaking of the celery, I liked that Gabby totally called Brad out on making a mess with the celery and the walk-in.
Yes, it was he messed the whole thing up and was like, oh no, it wasn't me. And Gabby was like, it was, I know you, that was who it was, like, don't try and get out of this. I did pick up a good tip from Brad in this video, which is I'm saying it like it's shocking and a surprise that I might learn something, but he carried, did you notice when he was carrying that big stock pot around, he was using a wooden spoon and levering it around the handle so it was easier, he was using that as like leverage to get a better grip on it so that it wasn't so, I guess, awkward to move around. And I was like, that's such a clever idea. I would never think of that.
Oh, so interesting. That was, I thought he was doing that because the handles were hot maybe and he, I guess, didn't want to use a towel, but that makes sense.
I think that as well. But I think also using a longer handled thing, you're using like physics, I guess, to like to be less of a awkward thing to carry. But yeah, I think probably the heat as well is the other thing.
One of my last notes that I really enjoyed, I know, like you mentioned Anna Stockwell earlier, I really liked that because she had dropped something on the floor, her little like title card was touring cast member Stomp.
Yes,
which was a bit of a blast from the past.
She dropped her pots and pans and made a big clatter.
Speaking of titles, I think that this one had the funniest title to me to date, which was when Carla was bouncing the spoon and her title was Uri Geller, which is such a funny reference to me. I loved that.
That was funny. I thought that was hilarious as well.
Next up, we have another Test Kitchen Talks. Pro chefs make their favorite cocktails. 10 recipes.
This is the content I'm here for.
It's also the most controversial video of this batch because they had to change the thumbnail because Corona was striking down the entire world. And the thumbnail originally had them all sipping a drink very close together out of one glass, and they had to change it because I think people were like, you can't do that anymore. So yeah, that was, I thought that was interesting that they did that as a, like, I guess a precaution to stem off any criticism, even though obviously this was recorded way before it being a risky thing to do. But yeah, it was, I thought,
yeah, well, because it was Dry January was what Delaney said, so
yeah, exactly. It does make me think though how I had noticed actually in a couple of the other videos preceding this, there's, I mean, you know, in Gourmet Makes where they chuck the stuff at Claire from the freezer or the fridge or whatever, and sometimes she doesn't catch them and they go on the floor, and normally like we just don't really bat an eyelid at that, but these days. I'm like, oh God, like, where's, you should be chucking stuff around a kitchen in these times, like, don't do it. So I just think it's interesting to see how, I mean, obviously the content that they put out will have to shift because people are having to record from home and that kind of thing, and mm-hmm. the type of yeah. thing they're gonna do is gonna have to change a little bit, but just because we can't get our hands on ingredients as much, and that's going to be difficult. But I just think it's gonna be interesting to see how they navigate this period and this video and the change of the thumbnail, I guess, is the kind of the first thing that sparked that off in my mind, that things are going to get very different around here.
Yeah, it's interesting to me that they did make those changes and that they unlisted the original video and I guess edited the original video so that they didn't share the drink at all. It's good to be responsible, but at the same time, I think it's a little unfair to expect
yeah.
every content creator to retroactively change their content in order to reflect what's happening today. Now. It's yeah. not like we're going to yeah. go back and edit every single TV show or movie where people shake hands or go no. to a restaurant. So yeah. maybe cut BA a little slack, everyone. We joked about yeah. it on our own Twitter, but it was solidly a joke.
Yeah, I was like, maybe they did it because of your tweet, Meg. And you were like, I hope not. I was just joking. But yeah, I think most of us are like intelligent enough to know that stuff's been recorded in advance. So obviously they're not suggesting that everyone do this now. But yeah,
interesting. Stay 6 feet away. Mm-hmm. Don't share a pineapple. You know,
no,
basic all stuff. The stuff.
Yeah.
Well, I was going to ask, is that the same recipe that you did for your piña colada?
Yeah, it sure is. It's BA's best piña colada recipe, which I made in a side dish episode. Molly added salt to it because, of course, she did. But otherwise, it's exactly the same recipe. And Delaney also made the Little Ripper cocktail, his own creation, in this video. So I've made 2 of 10. I kind of want to make all 10 of these.
I was going to say, it could be your quarantine challenge. Make all 10. Get your hands like on a good all challenge the alcohol. To me. It's going to see you through.
I saw a rumor on Facebook today. I mean, it was from like an Eastern Bloc country. I can't remember which one. But some doctor there was like, you can help fight coronavirus by drinking hard liquor. So there you go.
Perfect.
Buy into that hype and just drink all the hard liquor.
But yeah, I'm a person who enjoys mixed drinks, so I definitely enjoyed this episode. And honestly, I would be interested to try most of these. Sola's Old Fashioned sounded great. I love an Old Fashioned anyway, especially with rye. Oh, LJ's making faces.
I don't. Old Fashioned is Russ's favorite drink. He loves whiskey. I can't. I try it.
Oh, really?
Often. Yeah, every time he has one, he's like, try it. You might like this one. And I'm like, okay. But I'm like, it's just too... to me. I don't like it. I don't like the taste. And tequila is another spirit that I can't handle because I had too much of it in my wayward youth.
Ah, yes.
Yeah. But I love gin. I love rum. I love... those are my two faves, probably. But I also like vodka and stuff. But there weren't too many... There were some that I liked the look of. The Priya's cocktail, the shikanji, that looked really interesting. The
I really want to try that one.
Limeade, although that was tequila-based. So then I was like, oh, I'm not sure if I would like that if it's tequila-based. But the concept sounded good. Maybe I'd try it with a different yeah. spirit.
I loved when Sola said, Priya, this might be your best work.
I think of all of this group of drinks, my favorite looked like the white Negroni because I do really like botanical drinks and I've never had a white Negroni before, so I probably like that the best.
It's like a Negroni put on a nice pretty dress.
Sola yeah said. Exactly. I find it funny that Sola was there trying all the drinks.
I loved that, and she said that she would often make the Meg. Old fashioned to drown her sorrows. I'm like, you okay, Sola?
You okay? Yeah, yeah. I feel like if we worked in the test kitchen, you Meg, you'd be the Sola of this.
Oh,
this
absolutely.
Video.
I would be. I would live for the Delaney drink drop.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yes.
Everyone should have that in their lives.
Actually, one of our listeners, Cass, made the spiked shikanji and shared a picture on Twitter.
Ooh. Oh, I didn't see that. That sounds good.
Yeah.
I've never heard of an Americano. I always thought that was a coffee, but apparently it's a cocktail as well, as Carla mentioned. So that was interesting to me.
It seemed really similar to the Little Ripper, except instead of Amaro, it had Campari and the vermouth.
Yeah, yeah. Very similar type of vibe.
I'm not a big Campari fan, though, so I think I'd probably go with the Little Ripper over the Americano. Do you guys have any opinions on frozen margarita versus on the rocks? I'm solidly an on the rocks person.
I don't really, it doesn't really matter to me. I just prefer sugar instead of salt on the rim.
Blasphemy.
Because it's honestly like when I've had salt on the rim and the salt falls in, I end up getting a really like upset stomach from it. So I have to, yeah, I don't know what it is. It's something with when the salt drops in, it just, my stomach does not like that at all.
Are you sure that's not the tequila? I don't like margaritas because of the tequila issues I was talking about. But
makes sense.
My favorite, I mean, I always think of a margarita as a really fun, like, vacation type drink. And I'm always really sad when I can't have it because I'm just like, I wouldn't do well on with margarita. But my favorite equivalent and what I usually ask for if other people are having margaritas is a mojito, because that's my fave.
Oh yeah,
or a caipirana, or I don't, is that how you say it, a caipira, whatever that, what is it, I can never pronounce it. Do you know the one I'm talking about?
Yes, the Brazilian drink.
How do,
right?
You say it? Yes, that's it. It's, I knew it was from South America somewhere.
My only note on this was, would drink most of these. Well, the Andy one, because it had grapefruit, I can't drink right now, as we've established before. I can't have grapefruit on one of my current medications. So I was like, oh, man, can't try that one. Aww. But everything else. Next up, we have Gourmet Makes again. Pastry chef attempts to make gourmet Girl Scout cookies. My first note is, we've got to talk about if we were Girl Scouts and what our favorite Girl Scout cookies are.
Absolutely.
Can I just, we do need to talk about that, but can I just point out, confession, we don't do Girl Scout cookies in the UK.
Yes.
And I know of them because I obviously consume a lot of American TV and media, so I know what they are, but I always assumed that they were like homemade cookies that Girl Scouts had made and were selling for charity.
Oh,
I had no idea they were like a packaged, like manufactured product until this video. So I've really learned something today, guys.
Well, what, because I know it's not Girl Scouts, but Girl Guides in the UK.
What age are Girl Scouts?
5 to 18.
Interesting. So we have like a 3-tiered system when it comes to guides. So we have Girl Guides, which is like, I guess from, I think it's like around 11 till 18 you can do, and then you can become like a guide leader where you're like helping out with the people who run the Girl Guides. But then before that, from the age of about 7 to 11 you are Brownies, and then before that, from like 5 to 7 you're Rainbows. And I didn't do Rainbows, but I did do Brownies for like a year and I really didn't like it. So then I never graduated and made it onto Girl Guides. So
so you're Claire.
Okay.
We do have Brownies and Girl Scouts too. I believe that's the starting tier, is Brownies first and then Girl Scouts.
Okay. Yeah.
So it's, they're all, so guess what? I was a Girl Scout all the way through college.
Whoa.
So, because you can be a college scout. I mean, I didn't do as much when I was in college, but yeah. I also, I'm an overachiever and I was in co-ed Boy Scouts as well.
Oh my goodness.
next phase, they're called Venture Crew.
I'm like, the co-ed Boy Scouts.
Yeah, Venture Crew. Anyway, so it's Daisies is when you're in like kindergarten, and then it's Brownies. And Daisies. Then you have, cute. Is it, there's Cadets at one point. Like there's different tiers, there's all different throughout, tiers. But the whole time you're considered a Girl Scout.
I totally forgot about Daisies. Completely forgot about that. I started Daisies. As a Brownie yeah. and then did the next level up, I think probably through grade school, and then stopped.
So I was the only one that was like, this is not for me.
I got a silver award and everything.
Oh, wow. I'm very impressed. I did it for like a year. But the thing is, it involved a lot of like time and effort and like having to drop you at different meetings and like different excursions and activities that they used to do. It was like very involved and hands-on. And my mum, I was like the oldest of four, so my mum just didn't have time to be like have someone like super into a hobby, because she was like, I can't keep track of like a million different hobbies. So it was like, I was like, okay, well, this is too much effort to like do. Because they like they used to have to go to church on a Sunday and do stuff, and like there were like all these trips and things, and like it was just too much for everyone to keep track of. So I did a year, like I got some badges. In my day, they weren't iron-on patches; they were ones you had to sew on. And my mum was like, "I'm not doing that for you," and I was like, "Okay, I guess I'll do it on my own." And I think that was part of it. I was like, "Nobody even cares, so I'm not even gonna try."
My mom would just put all my patches in a little plastic baggie and like clip it onto the sashes. But she was also a Girl Scout leader. Like, she was one of my Girl Scout leaders. We did all sorts of stuff. My Girl Scout troop, surprising no one, was a little bit more artistic. Like, we did camping and stuff, but when I was in high school, we took a trip to the Stratford Festival in Canada and like went to a bunch of Shakespearean plays and things like that, because that's who I am all the way through to my core.
Your badge then, that would sum you up, if we were going to do that in a Claire style, would be the overachiever badge. Is that right, Amanda?
For me growing up, yes, definitely.
What would your badge be, Meg?
I decided my badge would be procrastination, and I would therefore never earn it.
I think my badge would be enthusiasm.
When Delaney said his badge would be friendship and encouragement, I'm like, I'm pretty sure that is a badge. Like, I'm pretty sure that's legitimately a badge.
But I thought it was like, she was like, oh yeah, that's a good one, but Rhoda's gonna get it. And I was like, oh, don't take it away from him. That's so sad.
He tried so hard. I love that sequence where he kept coming back and suggesting his badges, and Claire just rejected him. The leisure badge, no. The Fast and the Furious badge, no.
His first answer when
I do think he deserves the Fast and Furious badge. Well, that's
the thing that made me laugh the most was when Claire asked him the question initially, and he was like, I've just realized I've accomplished nothing. And I was like, yeah, I get that. I feel that.
That was excellent.
Justice for Do-Si-Dos and Trefoils. That was my other thing.
No, I totally agree with their top three here. Samoas are excellent.
They are. Well, what is that your favorite one?
That's my favorite.
Meg? Yeah, my favorite is Tagalongs.
I've obviously never had any of them because I always thought they were homemade, but I had heard of Thin Mints, and again, I guess I just assumed that it was like a recipe that people made as opposed to like an actual branded cookie. But when I had heard of Thin Mints, I always assumed that I would like those the best, because they're my, I really love a mint chocolate cookie. Like, that's one of my favorite combinations. So I think if I were to try one, I would like that the most.
And the secret to Thin Mints is freezing them and eating them out of the freezer. Tastes excellent.
Oh, that's... really?
Mm-hmm. Oh, it is.
Great.
I do not like peppermint, but I like Thin Mints frozen.
Oh, interesting.
I think that everyone should definitely read the article by Alex Beggs, where she went behind the scenes on this particular Gourmet Makes the Girl Scout episode. It's a hilarious article. It really gives you a blow-by-blow, even hour-by-hour, of how a Gourmet Makes shoot goes. Loved it. Really entertaining. Everyone should read it.
My one last comment that I had about this video, because I thought it was such a contrast to the other Gourmet Makes, is how Claire with the bagel bites had everybody come in and help, like, you know, she wanted help from everybody, but clearly she really liked making these Girl Scout cookies. And when she was told she had to get help, she was not pleased.
No, she was not. She was like, I want to do this all myself.
How do you feel about the way you treated your friends, Claire? She's definitely not getting the friendship and encouragement badge.
Well, she was just like, I don't want you to be here, but thank you.
She earned that cookie diva badge for sure.
Yeah. So funny. I cannot wait to one day visit the Gourmet Makes Museum with that sash in and everything else.
Absolutely.
All right, next up, we have a reverse engineering, recreating Bobby Flay's macaroni and cheese carbonara from Taste.
This was a fun episode, but the worst part of it was discovering that Chris forgot to brush his teeth that morning. That literally made me feel so ill. All I could think about was like, oh my God, your breath must be terrible. And you've spoken to how many people this morning? They're your poor co-workers.
At least he was remedying it.
Well, I hope he brushed as soon as he got back to the office. That wasn't clear from the video. We've all talked about, I mean, obviously Justine loves Chris and has a big crush on him. I think he's like, you know, he's not necessarily my type necessarily, but I can see he's a cool guy. I like him. But like his points went way down when he said that. I was like, that is not hot.
And you know how much he loves his coffee. He's just been going around with coffee breath all morning.
Oh, the gross coffee breath is the worst. I hate it so much. Oh my God, it's one of my pet peeves.
I'm sorry. You being so disgusted by this is like my favorite thing today.
Yeah. Oh, just could. And I was like, why did they even have to put that in? Like, we could have been in blissful ignorance knowing that Chris, like, assuming that he has regular dental hygiene all this whole time. But now we know. Now the mask has come off. It slipped, literally.
I would like to say, in his defense, you don't know what was going on with his kids that morning.
Oh, please. No, it's not good. Even so. Anyway, moving on. I thought the concept of a mac and cheese carbonara in general sounded amazing because I love mm-hmm. both of those things. And mm-hmm. I don't know about you guys, and I think Gabby was on the same page by the end. I think Chris did a better job than Bobby Flay's original recipe, because Bobby Flay's original recipe looks like anemic and Chris's looked mm-hmm. lovely and deep and golden and like rich and tasty. And I was like, I want Chris's version.
I thought Chris's version looked better too. Honestly, I would eat both, but Chris's version did look great. I think that this is kind of exemplary of what he does on the show a lot, is that he tries to improve it, or he tries to do something to his personal preference instead of putting himself in the mind of the person who made the recipe. Yes. So it's something like, of course it's pancetta. No one's ever even heard of this
guanciale.
Guanciale.
I had to Google it. I had to Google it. I was like, what is it? And I was like, oh, it's just pork cheek, not pork belly. So it's basically the same thing, just from a different part of the animal. Fine.
Yeah, so I think Chris's biggest obstacle as himself is making it more gourmet and less accessible.
Yes.
I mean, that probably makes for a better end product, but it's maybe working against himself for trying to recreate the recipe.
The cheeses, like, he had Fontina in and then he took it out and he...
Cheese is his absolute nemesis.
Definitely, like, his Achilles heel.
Yeah. He can't get cheese right. And he knew his cheese combination wasn't right, but he still stuck to his original guns because he kept mm-hmm. saying like, oh, I think there's something else. I think there's something else. And I was like screaming at the screen, cheddar, cheddar.
Well, he also pepperino. Bought the Asiago and then just set it aside. And I was like, never mind.
He stuck to his finger guns, if you will.
Yeah, and he was like, oh, and when Gabby was revealing, like, the real ingredients, and he was like, oh, the ghost of what might have been, and I was like, no, that was Red Leicester, the ghost of, like, I was like, when he's, like, all his nightmares haunt him, they're just gonna be various cheeses floating around his head, with the things that he didn't pick up, when he should have done.
Red Leicester, cheddar regret.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, he was locked in that so carbonara funny. Paradigm, as he said.
Yeah, he was. I had no idea that he was such a Top Gun fan.
Me either. Like, that was so really entertaining. It. We learned something new every episode.
The way that he was like, Tom Cruise learned to fly a MiG for this, and we need to show him respect. I was just like, whoa. And then, like, he kept whistling the little theme music. It was amazing.
All I could think was, I hope for Chris's sake that coronavirus does not postpone Top Gun's release date, because Chris would be so sad.
Because, yes, I did actually think about that. It was like, God, so many movies are getting postponed until people can go to the movie theater again. So I really hope
you know, June, let's hope that June is here before we know it and everything's okay.
Yes.
Yeah, otherwise I think he's gonna have a meltdown.
Otherwise Top Gun will be the least of our worries.
So yeah, so it feels to me like Chris like improved the original recipe. So my kind of main summary is like, well, if this had been a Gourmet Makes, he would have done really well because he's improved the original idea. Sadly, it's a different show with different rules.
I also want to thank Chris through this video for introducing us to that Emeril Lagasse video he referenced, where Emeril was just walking through the Condé Nast building, spamming people with salt. It was a bizarre video.
Never seen that before. How do you guys feel about the fact that I think it's really funny that whenever he's scoring himself, he always overmarks himself based on what the actual score is at that moment in time. Like, his scores are always higher.
It's true, yeah. Always. Yeah, I don't think he's ever gone below.
I'm kind of surprised he hasn't adjusted at this point, because clearly he watches these videos. Yes. Because he
knows about the graphics. Yeah.
Yeah. It'll be like, push him away, push him away.
It feels like overconfidence, or maybe just confidence, is a shared trait among a lot of the Test Kitchen.
Yeah, I whenever I see that, I'm like, I should think a bit more like that. Like, maybe just assume that you've done 10% better than you actually have.
Yeah. And then our final video today is Trixie Mattel tries to keep up with a professional chef, back-to-back chef. And they made strawberry shortcake.
I think it's a requirement for every single guest on the show to do the salt bay.
Yes.
Has there been anyone who hasn't done the salt bay?
I don't think so. I can't think of one.
I really enjoyed this episode. I really love RuPaul's Drag Race. So anytime that Carla gets to do cooking with drag queens from the show, I think it's a delightful episode edition of it. I really enjoyed how much they seemed to enjoy chatting with each other, and that was really nice. And I thought Trixie was hilarious. It's always hard, isn't it, with this show, like striking the right balance between being funny but like disrespectful to what Carla's trying to do versus being so diligent that actually it's quite boring because you're not doing anything necessarily that interesting, you're just following Carla's instructions. So I think Trixie got the balance like exactly right, in my opinion, and because she was doing a good job, but she was also making time to like throw in a gag here and there. My favorite one was the when she was like, if you do some gentle kneading, and she was like, I need you. She made me laugh.
That was
so
my
much.
Favorite gag too.
I wrote, Carla should have more drag queens on and less gamers.
Absolutely.
I agree. You know what I did straight after this video in my recommended videos that came up on YouTube was like Trixie Mattel's 33-step everyday makeup routine for Vogue. And I watched that because it was hilarious. It was so funny. It was like taking it right from like no makeup, no wig, no nothing, all the way through to full Trixie Mattel glory. And it was fascinating.
That
I loved it
amazing.
So much. Yeah.
What you were saying about striking the balance between joking and being like a little bit mean but also respectful, I did think that Trixie's humor, I guess in general, leans towards what you could call mean, maybe. But unlike a lot of these other back-to-back videos where it just feels like people are being disrespectful or rude, you can tell that Carla knows what to expect. She's obviously a big fan of drag queens. I think that they have a sort of shared campiness. So it never at any point actually felt mean to me. It was just sort of playing along with the joke.
They were on the same page. I loved it when the hair and makeup guy came in to like check Trixie's makeup, and then Carla was like, what about me? And so she's like, oh, yeah.
I love when Trixie asked Carla, how do you cook and still keep a full face of makeup all nice and untouched? And Carla said that she doesn't touch her face when cooking, and I was like, yes, Carla, ahead of her time. Don't touch your face.
yes. But also, it wasn't just her face. Trixie was concerned about, because she
her hands,
has makeup
yeah.
on her hands, which I was like, why? But then when I watched the makeup video, I totally understood, because like what's yeah. underneath all that makeup is like nothing. They're not the same color at all. So she has to put makeup on her hands. So it's just hilarious. It's so good. I was like, I've never thought about having to have makeup on my hands before, but I guess these are the things you have to worry about when you're a drag queen.
Trixie is hilarious. And as they alluded to in the video, she was nominated for a James Beard Award in the journalism yes. category under humor, in case anyone was wondering.
What is the James Beard Awards? I didn't know what that was and I didn't look it up.
So I was curious about this too, because my understanding is that James Beard is usually cooking related. And I was thinking, oh, Trixie did something cookie related, but I guess it's a wider realm of awards than I thought.
Oh, yeah. It does say they're usually to recognize the culinary professions. So, I mean, I guess Trixie did something to do with humor and
I believe
cooking.
She did a video about making cocktails, but I couldn't verify that 100% that that was what she was specifically being nominated for.
Okay.
Well, that explains why she's like, I'm never going to get nominated for it again.
Right?
That's funny.
Unless, oh my God, what if she got nominated for this video?
Whoa.
Yeah. I'd hope it was a joint nomination with Carla as well, though.
Absolutely.
Well, yes.
Yeah.
I loved the whiskey business joke.
Yeah, I loved that too, because I love a pun. That yes. was funny. And when she was reenacting Scream, I loved that as well, because I love anything like 90s. So funny. I've never heard of family consumer economics. Is that really what cooking and like learning how to cook is called in schools? What? I don't even
know
what that
means.
When I
was in school, it was still home ec.
It was home ec when I was a kid. But as we know, Carla has young kids. So I'm guessing she knows what the curriculum is called nowadays.
It's called food technology, or it was when I was at school, because I think they were trying to get away from this, like, oh, it's just for housewives thing. So it's called food technology because you don't just learn about food, but you also learn about like packaging and I guess how food is manufactured and like that kind of thing as well. So, yeah, it was just interesting to me because I was like, family consumer economics. What does that mean? I don't even know what that means.
In my home ec, we learned cooking and sewing. So make of that what you will.
Yeah, same.
Oh, we had a separate like textiles class you could do. But again, that wasn't like just like home sewing. It was more like if you wanted to go into fashion, like this is how you would produce stuff. These are different techniques for fabric and stuff.
I should have lived in the UK.
Yeah. I actually did textiles as my like we have exams when you're like 16 that are GCSEs, and textiles was my like module because you could pick out of either food tech, textiles, or I think they call it design technology, which is like woodwork and something to do with electronics, I think. But yeah, I did textiles. So we had to like come up with a design for a piece of clothing and make it. And then there was like a fashion show at the end of the year and it was really fun. Yeah, it was really cool.
I made a pillowcase.
Yeah, I hope that Trixie Mattel comes back and does some more videos with Carla the way that like Miss Cracker has.
Yeah, that would be great. I thought they were great together.
Well, that is all we have for our recap. So next up, we need to decide what is our favorite video and what dish we would make from this bunch. LJ, how about you go first? Because Meg looked like she didn't know.
I know. Wow. I know.
I know.
I have notes.
Oh, well, then you go first, Meg. You go first.
Okay, I think my favorite one was the Girl Scout cookies Gourmet makes, because I really enjoyed how much fun Claire seemed to have with it. I really enjoyed the crafting element when she was making her sash. I really enjoyed learning what Girl Scout cookies even were. It was a video full of revelations for me. I really enjoyed that one. I think it was like a nice Gourmet makes video. And I think which one I would make... I think, in all honesty, I'm most likely to make Brad's Master Stock or a version of it, because I make stock so often and it's always nice to have like new ideas for stock and how to make stock more flavorful, because I use it in a lot of stuff as well. So I think that would be the one I'm most likely to make.
What about you, Meg?
My favorite was also the Gourmet Makes Girl Scout cookies. if not for having to record this podcast, I think this might have been a video that I might have saved for myself as a treat to watch when I'm feeling maybe particularly stressed out about the world today. But I'm so glad that I did watch it because it's exactly the kind of content that makes me feel happy right now. It's very nostalgic and very soothing and just pleasant to watch. So I particularly enjoyed that one. And yeah. As I kind of alluded to, the recipe that I'm most likely to make is all the cocktail recipes. Honestly, two down, eight to go. I already have all the ingredients.
You could do it.
I know. I already have all the ingredients I would need to make the old-fashioned. So yeah, I think I might try to tackle this endeavor. I don't know over what time span, but I'm going to keep chipping away at it. Nice. What about you, Amanda?
So my favorite ended up being the Bagel Bites Gourmet Makes. I really like the Girl Scout cookie one too, but I think I just liked how she worked more with her friends in the Bagel Bites one and all the little tiny ingredients.
The pizza making party.
So yeah, that ended up being my favorite. And then the dish I would probably make would be the strawberry shortcake, because I think there's a Carla video.
There is.
Of actually making that I already have tagged as a possibility. So
yeah. Nice.
Yeah. I think on the BA recap draft on Twitter, it's going to be a Gourmet Makes winner for sure. It may end up being a Gourmet Makes versus Gourmet Makes final.
I think it might be. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we would like to do a few shout outs to our listeners. I know we've mentioned some throughout the episode, but wanted to thank Mary, our resident mom, for listening to our last recap.
Thanks, Mom. My real mom. Everyone else's
yes.
fake mom.
Honorary mom.
Yeah, honorary mom. That's the way to say it.
It's actually Mother's Day in the UK today. So thanks, Mary, our honorary mom. Happy UK Mother's Day.
Thank you to a couple of our listeners who wished LJ a happy birthday on her birthday.
You. Yeah, that was very kind. Thank you very much. I had a great day.
We had Bon Appetit Trip. And Margaret, who shouted you out. And speaking of Margaret, she very kindly said that the only thing giving me life in this time of madness are Bon Appetit videos and the Pod Appetit fan cast.
Aww, that's nice. And that is why we've decided to keep doing them, even though we all feel like shit.
It's all for you, Margaret.
It's not like we have to now learn how to do it remotely, because that's what we were doing already. So.
Yeah. I think it's a nice little distraction to think about the Bon Appetit videos for a couple of hours.
I have to admit, when I was watching them, it let me just kind of forget about everything. And I just felt really happy for a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
One thing that I wanted to bring up is we've talked about it privately, but we may be suspending most of our side dish episodes for now, because as we mentioned at the top of the episode, it's a little bit harder to find some ingredients, and like Meg is in the shelter at home. As we've been recording, I just got a bunch of messages from my family. Ohio just announced that we're going to shelter at home as of tomorrow. So
I live in London. We're potentially going on full lockdown is the rumor. Like, we just don't know, do we, what we're going to be able to get hold of. And so side dishes will be difficult.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
But we will continue to every other week do these recaps for sure.
And I certainly, and I'd encourage the others to do this as well, but I plan to keep storying what I'm making on our Instagram stories when I'm making stuff. So I'll try and do as many basically baking as I can keep up with. And if there's anything else that I can make that's BA related from what I have in my cupboard with substitutions, I'm happy to go on stories as well if you guys like that. So.
We do like that. I like it.
Yeah, I like watching your stories. Thank you all for joining us this week. Next time on the podcast, it will either be my side dish of the cluster cookies or another recap.
Just keep an eye out and surprise when we get it in your feeds.
Yes.
Thanks for listening to Pod Appetit, a Bon Appetit fan cast.
We'd love to hear from you, so find us on Twitter, Instagram, and Pinterest at pod_appetit.
And on Facebook at podappetitpodcast.
You can also email us at podappetitpodcast@gmail.com and find all of our episodes on our website, podappetitpodcast.com.
Until next time, the test kitchen is closed.
Hi, I'm Nicole.
And I'm Sarah.
And we're the hosts of the Georgia Made Podcast.
We're two indie filmmakers living in Atlanta, and we love talking about movies.
Making them, being in them, and watching them.
We wanted to celebrate our love of movies and TV, as well as share our own experiences working in the filmmaking community here in Georgia.
That's why we created this show. We watch films from Georgia's film history,
new films,
TV shows,
and independent films made by exciting new voices in the Georgia indie film scene.
Plus, we talk about local film festivals, indie filmmakers we know, and film and TV events taking place all over the Southeast.
The Georgia Made Podcast.
New episodes come out every other week on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Spotify, wherever you listen to your favorite pods.